Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Eric White. I'm a librarian at the Woodridge Neighborhood Library, which is part of DC Public Libraries. And I'm also a member of the Fotocraft Camera Club, which is based here in DC. Tonight, we're in for an exciting program that's connected with an exhibition that the DC Public Library is hosting called Washington, DC, City of Change, City of Interest, City of Change. And this exhibit came about as a result of the DC Public Library People's Archives acquiring a collection of photographs from a DC photographer who was very active during the 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, all the way up to the 90s. His name was Ed Fletcher. And the DC Public Library became aware of this collection through Irene Kellogg, who was a member of Fotocraft. And the library became very interested in this work that represented images that tell the story of DC and Afro-American families that lived during this period of time. The collection is made up of over 30,000 images. And it was acquired from the Ed Fletcher family and is being digitized and worked on now so that future researchers and people who want to know the story of what's going on and what went on in DC will be able to learn how Afro-American families lived. Today's program is called Changing Landscape of Photography from DC Photographers' Perspectives. And this is one of the shows that we are hosting connected with this exhibition to learn more from the photographers who are actually have work displayed in the show. The show is made up of 34 photographers, local photographers, and it was curated in partnership with the Fotocraft Camera Club and Exposure Group, Afro-American Photographers Association in DC. And this exhibit came about as a way of highlighting not only what's in the Fletcher collection and older Black photographers, but what contemporary photographers here in DC are doing now to show a visual perspective on how we see DC and what has been changing over the years. So tonight we have a special guest with us, Bonita Bing, who is the president of the Exposure Group. And we'll introduce two other photographers who are also in the show. Bonita has photos in the show. I have photos in the show. And to get a perspective on how things have been changing here in the DC area. One thing I do want to mention is that there are 34 photographers that are represented in the show, Washington, DC, a city of interest, a city of change. And there's actually 7 galleries. So it's quite a large show. So we invite you to go into the show that you get to from the DC Public Library website, and you will be going back and forth more than once because there is a lot to see, a lot of stories to be told. And we want to kind of share some of those stories this evening with Bonita and the guests that you will be meeting in a few minutes and to hear more about what you're in for. So with that, I'll turn over to Bonita. Take it away. I think you're muted, Bonita.
Sorry about that. Good evening, everyone. Thanks, Eric. And thank you for joining us with two of my favorite photographers, Sharon Farmer and George Dalton Tolbert IV. Sharon Farmer, photojournalist, first African-American woman to be hired as a White House photographer and the first African-American woman to become director of the White House Photography Office under the Clinton administration. Sharon is also one of the founding members of the Exposure Group. George Dalton Tolbert IV, photographer, was drafted in the U.S. Army in 1967 and served two tours of duty in the Republic of Vietnam. After returning home, he became chief photographer for Earl Howard Studios, located in Southeast D.C., and in 1992 was appointed the first African-American official U.S. Senate photographer. In 2007, he worked as an official photographer for the U.S. House of Representatives, becoming the first African-American to work for both legislative branches. Thank you. So, Sharon.
Yes.
I know that you started your photography at Ohio State University.
Yes.
So, inquiring minds would want to know, how did you get that job at the White House after leaving Ohio State University? So let's just go from Ohio State, you starting in photography there.
Well, I ran a Black student newspaper called Our Choking Times that I also took pictures for. And I discovered I could make more money shooting pictures on campus and off campus than grilling burgers in the student union. So that's how I got started. And then I was offered an internship by the video people at a TV station in Columbus, Ohio. But I like stills. I got D's and F's in video and movies. So no, I wasn't doing that. So I came back to Washington, D.C. And Sweet Honey and the Rock hired me to shoot their second album cover. And one good thing does lead to another. Meanwhile, I'm freelancing for the Washington Post. And the guy who hired me said he could tell my picture in the paper before he even looked at the photo credit. And there's no better compliment a photographer can get if somebody can see it's you before they read the name. So that was like, hey! So that's how I started at the White House. It was four of us. And eventually I became in charge. You know what they say? When you've seen how things are and you get to be in charge, you try to fix everything. And that's what I did.
Wonderful. Okay, well, why don't we look at some of your images?
Can you see the first one?
There we go.
All right. Rosa Parks is being feted by President Clinton and Congress. And that's Jesse Norman singing. We're all doing Lift Every Voice and Sing. Clinton could sing it. He knew all the words. He didn't miss a beat. And I was always ashamed of my Black people did not know the words. I run around with my camera everywhere and anywhere because you never know what you're going to see. If you don't take your camera, you're going to wake up in the middle of the night going, doggone it. Well, I hate that. So take it everywhere. This gentleman had been moved around from one spot to another with his church. The last spot was at where the Reeves Center is on U Street. And what's behind him is his church. And then beside him is what's left of his church. And then the CVS moved over there. You know what I think of that. Okay. Art, music, dance, all that stuff brings people together all the time. It really beats television. Interaction with people. What has this COVID showed me? I hate television. I love people. This is from the early days of go-go music, and the Junkyard Band is playing at the Anacostia Community Day. And it was a throwdown. Throwdown! Listen, if people in wheelchairs can demonstrate and march and make people know their stuff, people with two good feet, even if it's two left feet, we have to protest when things are not correct. But there's a new day in Dodge now. Everybody's trying to get along. Notice a couple in the front. Notice a couple under the umbrellas. It is a new day, so let's get real. Plus, if you got good family, and you have a good time, every day is a joy. Be dead. Nothing's going to happen for you. Medgar Evers is my hero. He died for our freedom. He fought hard, and they snuck up on him. They ambushed him. He was whacked. Martin Luther King, my other hero, he was whacked. Snuck up on him. Ugh. Hey, what is government about? Making sure what you don't know. A lot of stuff gets censored. They don't want you to feel your freedom, feel your art, feel who you are. I don't like that. Pictures are still worth 1,000 words. My man, how'd I get there? I explained that. What'd I do after that? Always do my best. Always had more gear than I needed. Even had more film and batteries than I needed. Because, you know, things go wrong. And I had backups, backup cords, backup flashes. I had a wide lux. I did all kinds of things. And no matter what he did, one of us was there. On this day, he's about to address the nation. And while they're getting ready, I see stuff. So I start shooting. The fun thing about the White House is you hear and see things you'll never read in the paper and probably not in the history books either. But I'm very clear about how government works and how it doesn't. On the right is Madeleine Albright, who was Secretary of State at the time. In the middle is Sandy Berger, National Security Advisor. The two guys in the back, Deputy Chief of Staff and Chief of Staff. There's a high protest, get down, throw down meeting as they make plans about what they're going to do. Not in the United States either, overseas. When Nelson Mandela came, I thought I'd died and gone to heaven because it was my third time seeing him. The first time we marched around the South African embassy for years with Trans Africa trying to get him free. And when it finally happened, it was so cool. And then to get to go to his inauguration with Mrs. Clinton's troop, and then to go back again with President Clinton. And then for Mandela to come to the Oval. Oh man, I can die and go to heaven tomorrow. These are the Delaney sisters who wrote their book called Having Our Say. One of them is 102 in this picture and the other one is 100. They were tough stuff, mind sharp as tacks, tacks, tacks. Mrs. Clinton paid a pilgrimage to them in Mount Vernon, New York. This is on Air Force One. President Clinton always came to talk to the people who were riding with us. And I always made sure I got photos of who's riding. Because it's not every day you get to fly Air Force One. Aha! This is my legacy. This is Ford over here. Matter of fact, he's in charge of the Ford Foundation, this black guy right here. Of course, you know the wonderful leadership of the National Council of Negro Women, Dorothy Height. And on the far side is her boyfriend. That is Sidney Poitier. That was we were celebrating her 90th birthday. But she was actually 94. No matter what happens, have a camera. Because if you see something that can't get it, you're not sleeping that night. And when you see things that are disturbing because we don't treat each other right, take that picture. And when people get together to celebrate how they've served for 8 years for the U.S. government, these are the good guys, y'all. These are the good girls. These are members of my sorority, Delta Sigma Theta. This is our current leadership, our national president, treasurer. It is the full-fledged throwdown women. And if you can look back thinking about all the things you love, you've lived a well and a good life. Thank you all for your attention.
Thank you, Sharon. That was great. Now, George. George?
I'm here.
Okay, George. So, George, you started your photography in Vietnam. So why don't you tell us the short story from Vietnam back to Washington, D.C., and how you became the first African-American Senate photographer?
Well, when I came back between the two tours in Vietnam in 69, my mother asked me where were the photographs. And I said, Mom, photographs? I got my fingers and toes, nose and everything. And she said, well, your cousin was there and he showed pictures. Okay, Mom. I said, I'll take pictures when I go back. Up until that period, I had never had interest in photography other than standing out in front of the house for my mother to take pictures when we were growing up. So when I got back, I paid $32.50 for a camera and started taking pictures. And be quite honest, it was just like a drug. I got hooked on it. I enjoyed it. I loved it. And I loved watching the pictures come out of the people that were around. I was taking pictures of people I didn't know, that didn't speak Vietnamese, and even also the GIs. And so when I came back, I brought some cameras back with me. I bought the PX. And I came back and I started taking pictures of anything and everything that moved or didn't move. And after a year of that, my dad asked me, he says, can you make any money doing all this? And I said, I don't know. Never tried. So in September of 1970, which is over 50 years ago, I shot my first wedding. After that, I did weddings on a regular basis, almost five or six a month, and sometimes even more. And my brother was working for Earl Howard Studios in Southeast DC. And he convinced him, my brother must have been a good salesman, because he convinced him to hire me sight unseen. So I showed up, never seen a studio lighting or anything or backdrop in my life. And so I learned how to take pictures. And probably in the 7 years that I worked there, I probably took at least 20,000 pictures from nursery schools, elementary, junior high school, and colleges. And so after that, I was working for the Senate. And to tell you the rest of the legend, I started at the Senate, not as a photographer. I started there in 1977 as a custodian. And during that time, because my hours were from 6 to 2, I started a company called Motorsports Photography International. And I shot motorsports from Canada all the way down to Florida on the East Coast and as far west as Ohio. During that time, I made friends with a page who later became Deputy Sergeant at Arms, who knew I was a photographer. And he asked me, would I be interested in going to the photo studio? And I said, I'd be interested, and forgot about it. I would say about 2 weeks, last 2 weeks of August, I ran into him accidentally in the hall. And he said, George, you start in the photo studio. I said, studio studio is what? I thought he was talking about a darkroom technician. No. He says, no, official photographer. Really? I was shocked. And as soon as he told me that, I was walking around a corner with another gentleman and the director of the photo studio. I ran into him. He says, George, I understand you're starting 1st of September. And I just want you to understand that you'll probably receive quite a bit of resentment. I looked at him in the eye and said, they'll get over it. And they did.
Yes, they did. I do know some of them. So now let's look at some of your images.
Next. This is Southwest Freeway, shot in the evening during rush hour. The idea, I was trying to get an idea of what rush hour looks like with a little movement. And that's why you see some blur. Some of the cars are sitting still, and some of them are moving. Next. A lot of people don't know, D.C. has its own soapbox derby, and they run down Capitol Hill. They block off the streets. And I happened to be out there one day, and like Sharon said, carry a camera with you. This is what you can come up with. Next. I've been fortunate enough, we've had three popes to visit the United States, and I photographed two of them. This is Pope Benedict doing his visit to the Shrine of the Immaculate Conception. Interesting, I was the only still photographer on the main altar when he came in and when he left. I was working for the Catholic News Service. Next. This is the Adams Memorial in Rock Creek Cemetery. The Adams Memorial is interesting. This was a memorial to his wife who committed suicide. She was a photographer, and she committed suicide by actually drinking some of the photographic chemicals that we use. Next. This is the opening of the Native American Museum on the Mall. I was asked by the gentleman carrying the flag, which is Ben Nighthorse Campbell, that he requested me to come in and photograph it. And this is the image of them marching to the museum itself across the mall. Next. Cricket. A lot of people don't realize there are all kinds of sports in D.C. Cricket is just one of them. This is at West Potomac Park. I'm driving around one Sunday and look over and see these guys and had no idea what cricket was. So I stopped, pulled over, took up my camera, and started taking pictures. Next. This says the 50th anniversary of the march in Washington, they had church services. What, this is probably one of my favorite photographs. The five people you see there on the left, the first lady, she is a rabbi. We have an imam. We have the Archbishop of D.C. We have a Sikh. And we have a Protestant minister at the end. They are singing a hymn. As you can see, the Archbishop, that's Whirl, is the only person who knew the words by heart. The other four were reading. And the lady in the black and white hat to the left, that's Martin Luther King's sister. Next. People. I'm a studio photographer, and I do people. Ben Lightsword Campbell was a motorcycle rider, and this is the second motorcycle that he had. This one was painted in Maryland, locally. And this was in President Bush's parade, the inaugural parade. And this was shot in front of the Capitol. Next. This is Senator Landrieu from Louisiana. She was running for re-election. And I had gotten a call after I'd retired to come and do campaign pictures. As a Senate photographer, we are bound not to do campaign work because it was illegal. And so she invited me to her house. So I brought all these lights, an assistant, makeup artist, and realized her house and her windows faced north. I had perfect light. And all I had was a camera and a tripod. And this is the one she used. And she was reelected. Next. These are my favorite two little girls. I took over 300 pictures of them to get them in the right place at the right time because they had all of this energy. They calmed down long enough to see this picture. When I showed it to her mother, she cried. Next. I like to take mothers and their sons. This lady on the right is my oldest niece, Kara, and her oldest son. This was taken during a holiday shoot that she wanted for her Christmas card. Next. This lady is an actress, and she had some photographs taken by a photographer in New York, and she wasn't happy, so she called me, and let's see what we can do. So this is one of probably about two dozen that we come from that shoot, and this is one of my favorite. Next. This is a coworker. The picture that some of you may have seen on my business card was taken by Joy. And so we were there at the studio, and I said, Joy, we need to take your picture. That shirt she's wearing is one of the props that I had in the dressing room. Put the prop on. She turned, looked toward it, and I said, Joy, look at the light. She turned toward the light, and this is what I came up with. This is also one of my favorite. Next. Twice I have done a salsa calendar, and this is from the last shoot that was done 2 years ago. And this is Marsha. She is probably one of the best salsa dancers I've ever worked with. And so far, I've worked with about 30. Next. This gentleman wanted some pictures done, but he didn't want the usual headshot. He wanted something to make him look powerful. I said, okay. So I took him to one of my favorite places called the north side of the Capitol and stood him up, and I shot him from a lower level to make him look powerful. And I asked him to fold his arms and look over my shoulder. And this is what I come up with. Next. This gentleman is Mr. DeWitt's Fried Turkeys. This was shot in a actual restaurant kitchen. We borrowed it, and he brought the turkey, and he had his own outfit, and I lit it with just two lights, and this is what we come up with. Next. Last but not least, this was one of my favorite shoots of all time. This is Professor Noodle. This was photographed when unusual. Instead of using studio lights, I shot this with six speed lights. Speed lights are the lights you set on top of your camera when you're shooting your family and your friends. And this took about an hour just to light. And he provided all of the props and everything, including the wig, the glasses, and the fake teeth. And this is it, and thank you.
Thank you. Okay, can we bring Sharon back, please? I just want to remind the audience, if you have any comments or questions, you can put it in the comments section, and we will get to your questions as soon as we can. Okay, you two. Now, we're in this COVID-19 situation and all these different restrictions we have going on. And I'm sure neither of you have seen anything like this in your lifetime. So my question is, how do you support your photography in this pandemic?
I saved my pennies. I quit drinking wine, so I got more than $10 in my pocket. I made some decisions that in order to survive, I need to just be cool. So I have so many images through the years. If I don't archive them now, then when? I certainly don't want anybody going through my 50 plus years of photography and not knowing what it means and not peering hard enough with a loop on the negatives or the slides to understand what I was doing. So I'm clear, if I don't tell my story, the monkey will. Sign the monkey. I've been told this story for more than 40 years. I got told this when I was still in college at Ohio State. And that's the reason I started putting down what it is, what year it is, what month it is. If you don't do this, your brain can only absorb but so much. My file cabinets overrunneth inside my head. But I'm cool. Because when I ain't doing photography or archiving my stuff or figuring out what I can throw away and what I need to keep, I play music so I don't go crazy.
Okay, thank you. And what about you, George?
All I can say is, Sharon, I'm glad I'm retired. This is unreal. Going as a studio photographer with the first pandemic rules that came out, we were closed. And even now, I'm still not comfortable with trying to do it. So I'm just going to wait until most people get their vaccines and we can try something else. Now, since the pandemic, I did shoot one wedding indoors. Made me nervous, I admit. And I said, I won't do that again. And I did shoot a job at Howard University for Marvin Jones once with my team. And we shot the incoming medical students and the senior medical students. And the way they did it, it was perfectly safe. We never come near the students. And you're talking about 6 feet. I was shooting them at 12 feet away with a long lens. And they better not even think about coughing or sneezing. But they did it very well. So I'm looking forward to when this thing die, not when I say die, when it comes back to, and whether the new normal is going to be, is being prepared. And like Sharon, I have a stack of books that I haven't read, that I am reading, that I have read. And I'm also going back and repurposing some of my old images. And some of them that you crop or you edit the first time, you go back and say, what the devil did I do this? And you go back and you redo them. And you've got brand new pictures. Some I've turned to black and white. Some I've altered the colors. Some of them I've changed things. But most of them, it's been fun going back, looking at things that you didn't even know you have. Now, and like you, I probably got about 30, 40,000 slides, negatives, prints. I have 175 framed and matted images in my personal collection of my stuff that I was hoping last year, which would have been my 50th anniversary, to do a 50-year retrospective. Didn't happen because of COVID. So I still have them. They're still there. And I hope to keep shooting because this is what I love to do.
Well, maybe you both can come out with some books.
I look forward to getting a lot more done Because as you watch every day flirt away faster and faster, you're pretty clear. You got shelf life. And when that shelf life is over, you may get moldy if you haven't gotten your stuff. Mm-hmm. So I don't want to be moldy. And I want my stuff done, which means I got to do it. So right, do I have helping? No, I'm doing it. I won't let anybody in my storage. Sharon, we'll help you. No, you won't. COVID is on. I don't want no company.
Exactly.
I'm fine with this. At some point in life, because we all move around so much, we don't stop to talk to anybody and look in their eyes. Now through Zoom, not only can I see your eyes, I can talk to you. And it's a full screen. It don't get better than this. There's nothing on television unless you're taking a class on how to shoot something better, play some better music. If you've never thought about a musical instrument before, that's my solace. That's my muse. That's my meditation time. Relax your mind. Do something you've not done before. Maybe you miss roller skating. Roller skate. You miss playing jacks. Play some jacks. Hey, you want to shoot some pool? Tell your uncle you're coming over. Tell him to get the hell out the basement, okay?
Okay, the next question. What do you guys see the current role of Black photographers now and in the future?
Let me give you the observation I've seen of the current demonstrations and whatnot have been going on for the last year. And it became very obvious to me where it has going and where it has been. If you look at the white photographers who come to shoot the demonstrations, they will shoot normally the white protesters. The Black photographers come to the demonstrations, they shoot the Black photographer. There's nothing wrong with that. But that shows you where it's necessary for diversity, which you don't have, because you're only getting one perspective. By having both, you have two perspectives of the same thing. And that's where your truth comes from in anything. And I hope that continues. But we need diversity from the photograph editors, hopefully some owners of some of these picture stories, because most of television is all mindless to me. I don't watch television like Sharon does, because there's really nothing there for me. I haven't had a television in 13 years, but I haven't missed any news because it's online. You know, I subscribe to the Washington Post and digitally, and I can see everything in the paper because everybody needs to read a paper. Now, whether it's truth or not, you need to read it. And I'm subscriber to probably six different places, including Al Jazeera, Fox 5, and the rest of them, because I want to see news from every perspective. So you can tell who's lying and who's not. And whereas photographers go, we have to tell our story. Nobody else is, because other people are not interested in what we're doing. And that's true of the Hispanic community, the Asian community, the Muslim community, every community. We need to do it. And this show that we have shows a perspective from the African-American perspective of DC, of what it looks like and what it means to us.
Yeah, that's just a tip, Berg, of the images that we have, because I know you have more than what is seen in this gallery. And what about you, Ms. Farmer? Well, what do you see the current role of Black photographers now and in the future?
I like when they do throwdowns. You got an image, I got an image. I don't care what two images you got. One is going to be stronger than the other. It's like playing poker, but you know you're right. So you have to challenge people to say, so what'd you get? This is what I got. And they got to show off or go home, okay? It's still about pride in our community as they gentrify the hell out of us. It's still about maintaining history. If we don't show it, they're not going to do it. And you better believe me, the real estate companies that are coveting our town and areas and neighborhoods, they got their own perspective so they can be chic and modern and futuristic. But the bottom line is they're pulling the rug out from everybody's family who's been living here since after 1850, okay? We paid our dues. We built this town. We built the monuments, the Capitol, the Lincoln Memorial. Listen, we have to exert our brain power, our ability to get tasks done. And guess what? If we don't meet about something to irritate somebody about at least once every 2 weeks, ain't gonna be no change. If you don't go to your city council meetings, if you don't go to the hearings on historic preservation, next thing you know, they destroying your stuff, destroying your landmarks in your own neighborhood, and they ask you nothing.
That's very true. I see we have a question in the comments section, so let me see what we have from Megan Amitage. I think that's how you pronounce the name. What are the cameras you work with or your favorite to work with?
Anything that works. It's a camera. It's a tool. It's like a car. Get me there.
I agree 100%. It's not the camera. It's what you do with it. Friend of mine named Jahi works for the Post, had a talk one time. He said something that even resounded with me. He held up a cell phone. He said, a cell phone in the hands of a professional is a professional camera. The top of the line Nikon or Canon or Sony in the hands of an amateur is still an amateur camera. So it doesn't matter what you use, it's to go out and use it.
Great, thank you.
But for the record, I'm a Nikon person and Sharon is Canon.
Canon.
Whatever.
So tell me, what is your most memorable photography assignment or assignments? I'm sure you have more than one because I know you guys have done, I mean, you know, you have over 50 years of photography experience. So do you have that one memorable photography assignment that you have done?
Yeah.
You want to go first, Sharon, or you want me to go first?
You go first. You go
okay. First. Well, I'm going to put it this way. I was Senator Frist's Codell photographer. I've been to four continents with him. I've been to France. Let me try to name some of the countries I went to briefly. I'll start in Europe. France. Spain, Portugal, Iraq, Japan, Korea, North Korea, China, and Taiwan, and Southern Africa to Mozambique, Botswana, Namibia, and South Africa. And traveling and seeing the world, especially seeing Africa, it's a mind-boggling and mind-opening to see the lies that we have been that perpetrated on us about Africa and find none of them to be true because I saw them with my own eyes and talked to the real people who live there just like us with the same aspirations that we have. They are truly our people. And to go there and have them, when I walked down the steps of the plane and they greeted me and they said, "Welcome home." And a chill went through my body, and they were right. You were home. But that is the thing I appreciate the most, and my best assignment was going around the world with him.
Okay,
and if you're out there listening, and if you're out there listening, Senator Frist, thank you again.
That's the best way to travel.
And I have been on Air Force Two, not Air Force One.
Okay, Sharon.
Yes. The first day that I was starting to cover stuff for the Clinton folk, because I wouldn't tell nobody that they had called me to say, "You it?" And I said, some of my friends playing a joke on me. I ain't telling nobody nothing. So I didn't tell my mom. I ain't tell nobody because this could be a joke. Five of us had applied to be photographers for the inauguration, and I'm the only one hearing from somebody. Something wrong with this. So when the lady called saying my husband's looking for you, I got 30 pictures to get out before noon, and it's 8 a.m., which means I ain't got a lot of time to dry and print, okay? So I hung up on her. She called back the second time.
You hung up on her?
Yes, I did, because I listen, it's a joke. I don't believe it. I'm from D.C., Southeast. I know what it is.
That's amazing, because both of you guys are from Southeast D.C.
Hi to the people. So I didn't believe her. She calls back a second time. I hear the voice. I'm like, I can't deal with this. I got to get this stuff out. So I hung up on her again. When she called back the third time, she said, "Hey, listen, you. We were at a party last night. Half the room knows you and your phone number." Then she tells me where she was. And I'm like, okay, I still ain't gonna tell nobody.
Let's see.
My mother always said, never try to fry an egg before it's ready. So I don't talk about stuff until I know it's locked in stone, that it may be possibly real for real. But I got to have proof. I'm one of your dowdy Negroes, okay? I don't believe nothing till I see it or feel it. And I wasn't feeling none of that, wasn't seeing none of that. What I believe in? My peers, my parents, my relatives, my good friends, my good buddies from Ohio State, my Delta Sigma Theta sorors. The other stuff can go by the wayside. So the first day I had to be at Georgetown campus to hook up with the two principals and their spouses, then I'm saying to myself, I still ain't gonna tell nobody. May not last a day. What's all these guys with guns and this ain't my people. So I'm not sure I'm gonna last, okay? Because as much of an adventurer as I am, listen, I got an FBI record. I marched at Ohio State. I tried to cause mayhem, but I didn't do it destructively. We did it through education, through the Black Student Newspaper. We brought down people who knew what the hell they were talking about, and we were wiser for the day of it. And so because of that, because I would not help the other people, they gave me an FBI record. I even know who the snitch was. I'm gonna get him one day. Yes, I am.
Thank you. I see we have some more questions in the comments section, so let me get a question here. Okay, we have a question from Phyllis Anderson. Love the work. What is the skill set needed to be a great photographer?
Curiosity and eagerness to do something more than watch television.
George?
I agree. I call it being nosy. I am nosy. And I have an eye to wander around to see what's behind the next thing. And not afraid to ask the questions. And I'm not afraid to seeking out things that I'm not familiar with, no matter what it is. But the other thing is, you have to develop your eye. You have to take that natural curiosity and develop your eye of how to capture and how to composition and how to use your camera. And the only way to do that is to practice.
And that's with anything. Practice.
It's true. My bass clarinet playing, getting better and better. Piano, I'm like, oh, hey, throw that. I'll never be Les McCann or Hazel Scott, but I love trying.
Okay. So, what do the two of you want your legacies to be?
Serious about their work while they were having big fun.
I'll second that. I want my legacy to know that, with people to know that I tried to help other photographers, because there were photographers who were older than me who were not relatives or friends or didn't even know me. I guess they felt sorry for me, who helped me. And I tried to help everybody else. That's why I'm a member of Exposure Group, because to give back, because all the people helped me, they're all dead. And it's my turn to help other photographers come and try to be as best as they can, because they did help me. You cannot do this alone. If you think you can, you're wrong. And if you want to join the Exposure Group or Fotocraft, that's a good start.
Join somebody so you're never having a bad day. When's the last time I had a bad day? It's been a long time.
I don't have bad days. I give bad days.
Okay. What was the best advice you both were given?
Get there early, stay late.
Get there early and stay late.
That's when the best pictures happen. The stuff that's not scripted, the stuff that's not planned. That's when you get into the photojournalism side or whatever event you're shooting. You can get feelings. You can understand the relationships between different people. You can tell who the boss is. You can tell who likes the boss, who can't stand the boss. You can also figure out who is really the person you need to talk to, no matter what they told you in the letter or the email or the phone call. Because if you watch how people talk to each other and how they get around the room checking on stuff, or there's a wedding going on, Who's really in charge? The bride or the groom? The party planner? The mother-in-law?
And I'll piggyback on that, is pay attention 360 degrees around you. Your best picture may be behind you, not in front of you.
That's the truth.
So always, always look behind you and pay attention. The best advice I've ever gotten was from my grandfather. He said, boy, he can call me that. He said, never let your ethnicity, your race, be an excuse not to succeed. Bet you didn't try hard enough. And I agree.
That was great advice. Let's see, we have some more questions. Okay, we have one from Deborah Kane Kemp of Fotocraft. What is the one great photo that you did not get? The one great photo that you did not get.
That's the nightmares. I can't let you sleep at night. Oh, God. I started to take a picture of President Clinton doing something. And then I realized the battery was freaking dead. And I'm like, what? But because I carry 3 and 4 cameras, all kinds, I had the wide lens closest to my finger. I took the wide lens, which makes a big, long, narrow picture, and shot it anyway. It came out great, but I really wanted to use the other lens. But this is life.
George?
I think the one picture that I didn't take was early in my career, probably in the early 73. Coming down New Jersey Avenue, there was a car accident. And there was a lady leaning over her son. Her son was on the ground. He wasn't dead, but she had her hands up, her flinch clips, screaming at the sky. It was a perfect picture, but nobody was attending to her son. So I got out with a blanket and a pillow, and I covered the boy up and comforted him until the ambulance got there. But that was the picture I wish I had taken. But unfortunately, sometimes you have to help people other ways, and the picture's not that important. But the little boy was okay. He was just shook.
Oh, that's great. So we have a comment from Lisa Fanning, Exposure Group member. Some of my favorite photographers. Thank you for sharing your stories with the audience. Okay. Next question. Give us one photography tip or recommendation. Or maybe two.
I got the best one.
Okay.
Read your manual. And wherever you go, wherever you have in your camera bag, make sure it's in there. And I'm going to be honest. With digital cameras, I can forget. There's too many things that can be set wrong. It has happened to me, and I can't figure it out on the menu. I go to the book.
So true. So true. Sharon?
I always think the one thing is to not get off your track. If you know you have to be somewhere at a certain time, and you know traffic gets messed up, at least start early. So I give myself a two-hour leadway going, you got 2 hours before you're supposed to be there. You should leave now. You know you got to park, and when you find parking, you know you got to haul your stuff. And you know it's going to take your time to get there. So leave early, because when you leave early, your client's impressed. I'm impressed that I get there early. But the bottom line is you're going to get stuff you're not going to get during the program. And then if you stay an hour afterwards, all the things that you were hoping to get during the program just start happening. And that's where my best work comes, when people don't expect me to be shooting, because everything is choreographed from the speaker to the dinner. The thing about photojournalism is you don't know what you're going to see till you get there. Photojournalism is always the best deal. And I get hired because of my photojournalism skills, not because I shoot food good or I know how to shoot a portrait, which I can do too. So when they say, Sharon, you do da-da? Mm-hmm. You do Zoom? Yeah. Uh-huh. You have to do stuff to keep yourself engaged, keep your clients engaged with you, because everything is changing. And they keep junk on television. I don't care what the hell's going on in Atlanta, Georgia. Okay. the mindset about intelligence and what you learn is important. Do we have to be entertained all the time? In the old days when Zora Neale Hurston was alive, Dorothy Height was running around, Lord have mercy, Mrs. King was busy trying to help her husband. We have to do things to keep everything on the good foot. It's not going to come without work. Join organization, support the ACLU. Help people help people, because in the long run, you're helping yourself too.
That's so true. And there is power in numbers. Power in numbers. So we have one more question, because I think we're going to have to wrap it up soon. I know we can go for like 5 hours, because I know you guys.
5 hours? We can go for a week.
I know you can, George, but we don't have that much time tonight.
Darn it.
So I'm going to get the last question here in the comments section. And it is from Deborah Kane Crane Kemp again. What do you see yourselves doing after COVID-19? After everyone has gotten their shots or supposed to get their shots, what do you see yourselves doing after this pandemic is over? Or will it ever be over? Who knows?
So this is the new normal. You call your clients up and go, okay, we back in business yet? But it depends on what they say everything is. So we're counting off Fauci and the CDC and everybody else to tell us we can breathe each other's air again, okay? Until that time comes, listen, I got plenty to do at home. I'm happy. I like home real fine. Got 2 cats. They're cool. Got a good partner. That's cool. We got good things going on. You have to wait for things to happen. You push them along going, hi, checking in. Whoever your client was, I'm just checking in, seeing how things are going. Use your Zoom meeting call, shot. You know, you have to make suggestions to people who don't think about everything, because all of our what's important in the top three, if you're not in the top five, they're not thinking about you. So you have to remind them, hi, still here. How's it going?
I agree. Only thing I'm looking for is to be able to go to a restaurant and sit down and enjoy a meal like a real human being. Until then, I have to put up with my own cooking.
Oh, Lord.
I got great cookbooks. You don't have to go to a restaurant anytime soon. Let's say your buddies, okay? No, great cookbooks, follow the recipe, as Joyce tells me, and I don't. She's like, did you follow the recipe? Well, I did. I told you to follow the recipe. Well, I did. And I go, well, I was trying. No, recipe.
But well, the other thing is what I miss is traveling. That's what I miss the most from COVID, is not being able to travel. Because I, like you, Sharon, I love trains. Civilized way to travel, but it'll be a while. But So what I do to amuse myself is plan logistics on, well, let's see, how would I get to so-and-so? And I also want to get back to one of my favorite places. Is good old San Juan, Puerto Rico. I miss it. But oh, soon. Great.
Thank you. Again, I want to remind the audience that you can check out this live presentation on the YouTube channel for the library, and also to check out the gallery in the exhibition. I believe that's in the chat area or the comments section. There should be some links there in the comments section for you to go to check out the exhibition. And next we will have Eric.
Thank you, George and Sharon. That was great. That was just one side and just a couple of views of the photographers who were represented in our exhibition, Washington, D.C., City of Interest, City of Change. Some of the things that you mentioned, Sharon and George, are very, very important. And that's one of the things that we want to kind of reemphasize, that with all the pictures that people are taking these days, you got to start to keep a record of what you're doing. You know, the library offers different workshops, and we're going to have one of those workshops near the end of the program in March that we want to invite people to come to. So you can learn how to start to archive and keep records and know where you want to put your pictures. You know, it's very important. We started out talking a little bit about the Ed Fletcher collection, and the fact that that collection is at the DC Public Library is because someone had a vision, you know, one of our members, Irene Kellogg, to bring it to the attention of the library. So that story about Black life in DC could be told and shared with others now. And the work that Sharon and George are doing, and you know what they're doing, you know, crosses a number of different barriers. You know, as you heard tonight, they work with a variety of different people. And as Black photographers, we are all about that. You know, we are not just photographing certain images. And in this show, you'll see the breadth of where we are as photographers. So on March the 4th is going to be our next talk, and that's going to be a visual perspective of DC through the lens of Black women photographers, and that's Black Women's History Month. We want to bring that to you next month, but in the meantime, be sure to go to DC Public Library website and check out Washington, DC, a city of interest, a city of change. And there's 7 galleries. There's a lot to see, like I said before, so you'll be going in and out. And you get to see the breadth of other photographers that are represented in this show. So thank you, Bonita. Thank you, George. Thank you, Sharon.
You're welcome.
I'm talking to you all. And check out Fotocraft and check out Exposure Group if you want to learn more about the craft of photographer and some of the talent that is in these clubs that you can learn from. So that's it. We'll see you next month.
Good night.
Good night. Good night.
Good night, everyone. Power to the people.
All right.
Good night, John boy.